Please.
It's very nice to be here again. I'm really thrilled to be asked back. Paula suggested talking about our successes, if you like, or whatever you want to call them, with the council, which kind of, I have to really go into a history of what we've been doing. I've met this chap sitting there, and he's put his hand up. When the council wanted to put in parking permits, we had to have parking restrictions outside our house. We went from every house in the road getting signatures, a petition. And we got 94 out of, I think, 98 people to sign. And we got the parking. We got it. It's great. It costs £35. No, we got it. We pay £35 a year to park outside our houses. So we scratched our heads. And we started up a website, a YouTube channel, which is called Talkie Talkie TV. It's really confusing. It's great that it's that confusing because it takes some fighting. And we started recording our visits to the council. And they became more and more interesting as they went along because, as I say, we found out about petitions. sadly, an old friend of my brother's passed away, and he was a bookbinder, and he left an 1890 Nuttall Standard Dictionary. So we kind of look up definitions of things in this dictionary. And a petition is a prayer or pleading from an inferior to a superior. Now, I know this off by heart. I've said it 1,000 times, and I'm sure a few of you have seen me before say this. So we realized petitioning was not going to work. So we started to object. Now, when you object to something, you're offering it up for a third party to give you some determination. So that didn't work either. So then the council, in their wisdom down in Torquay, they decided they were going to build two wonderful five-storey blocks of flats right on the front, where, you know, it's beautiful parade gardens, it's Prince's Gardens, beautiful. And that means, you know, moving the war memorial, all sorts of stupid things. So we went to many meetings, and there were very good-minded folks saying, let's do a petition. We said, let's not. So they said, well, what do we do? And we decided what we were going to do. We were going to withdraw our consent. But the most of the people in the groups, we found that was a step too far. That's, you know, just not, it's not the right thing to do. So one of our early films is we go to a meeting, and the mayor sitting there, he says, oh, I've given permission for this meeting to be filmed. Don't remember asking. And so we let that one slide. And then one after the other, these people from the groups, they sat down and they had their 3 minutes with their bits of paper telling the council, we don't really want you to build this building, these buildings. Please, please. And the mayor was sitting smiling at them. So I, what's the word? I had enough. I picked up the piece of paper that they put on the chairs to say, you know, this is how we're doing it, blah, blah. I said, it doesn't mention anything here about the people who have withdrawn their consent about this matter. I'd rather like you not to speak, please. That didn't stop me talking. So I asked them if they are governing by consent. No answer. The whole council, cabinet, the whole lot of them. This was the rubber stamping meeting.
Three times.
I asked him three times, because it's a magic number. And he asked me to stop talking three times, I think, if I would, please. No, I didn't. I finally left the room, saying, I withdraw my consent, I'm a friend of this town. Bye. That was, how many, seven years ago? Those buildings have not been built. So, I don't know if that's a success, but they haven't been built. And it's done by a notice of rejection. Or just a notice of withdrawal of consent. And it's done with your hand. We spent ages formulating letters. You wouldn't believe it. Some of the things that we came out with that were precised down from about four pages to four sentences. Because that's all you need. And it's all typed up in glossa, because we use the language they use, which now we know different. Everybody here know about glossa? This is an informed room, I know. Glossa. Okay. I'm speaking to you. You've heard this before. I said this in Winchester. I'm speaking to you in the mother tongue. I don't really need a microphone, because I can make the air vibrate and you can hear it right back there. It's making you move. Now, what people do, we've been taught symbols. And we can write down what that sounds like. It sounds like that symbol. It sounds like. Okay? That's called descriptive English. And then there are many languages that get written down. You go into a court, as I have been on a couple of occasions, I've been asked if I was this name. And this chap's reading a piece of paper. Now, I don't know what's on that piece of paper. It sounds like the mother tongue. But he's obviously reading it, so it can't be mother tongue. Because you can't write mother tongue down. It cannot be done. Right? So anybody who goes in there and answers to this bloke reading off a piece of paper, you're in for it. You're going to get everything they want to throw at you. So that's the language they use. The glossa is actually, it's very intricate, of course, because they don't want people to know this. Anything written in capital letters, basically, is a glossa. It's the definition in one of the law dictionaries is the language of the illiterate. Right, every headline you see on the newspaper, it's in capital letters. It's glossa. Each word should have a full stop after it, because it's not connected in any way to the next word. It just, they taught us how to read, so we read it how we think they've taught us. But it's not English. So the best way to do anything when you communicate with them is with whichever hand you use to write, a bit of blue paper, nice purple pen, and you do it in your own hand. No argument. Okay, and that's the secret of what we're trying to do, but I am anyway, is I don't want to argue with them. I'm tired of arguing with them. I'm fed up with arguing with them. I want no more conflict. So that is the basis of how we work. Something like, for example, council tax. I'm going to wander all over the place, because that's me. You know, I don't have a set list today. Council tax. Ask them if you can pay, please. I want to pay. But for that, I'm going to have to follow the law, and I require a contract, a lawful contract. And the lawful contract will include, I love that word, include. It will include, you know all this stuff, do you? You must have heard this stuff. The lawful contract will include full, thank you very much, what was that? Full what? Disclosure. Disclosure, yeah. faking it. Full disclosure, they can't change anything before and after. Once it's signed, it's signed, that's it. Whatever's in there, that's it. Consideration, each party gets what they want. Third one, lawful terms and conditions. Oh, there's plenty of lawful terms and conditions, but how does a fiction write lawful sign? And the fourth one is the wet signature of both parties, or all parties, right? So they can't do that, because Nottingham City Council is what they call mortmain, mortmain, French, dead hand. It needs an agent. Now, I don't deal with agents anymore. Yes. So the next thing we did in our council, we go to a few meetings, we fill them. As soon as we walk in, they're like, oh, they're here. Cameras on. And my brother, bless him, he asked the mayor, appointed the mayor. I wasn't there, but there was a councillor witness, there was three people witnessing. He appointed the mayor his fiduciary. Now, who knows what a fiduciary is?
Yeah.
Anybody not know? Okay. A fiduciary is what you think you're voting for in an election. Somebody who's going to do their best for you before themselves. Christ knows where that came from. A fiduciary puts your best interest first. So the mayor said, no. God, no. God, no, I can't do that. Right, okay. So I asked my councillor. He said no. And my favourite one was I appointed my MP on film, my fiduciary. And I love that one because I said to him, I said, I'm called Max Stuteley, man on the land, inhabitant. I don't know anything, I don't understand anything that goes on in Parliament. And he looked at me.
Really?
You're just the sort of
one. Oh. He's a QC, so he knows exactly what I just said to him, but he thought, I'm an idiot. Well, I am. And then I said, but I do understand that your position is a fiduciary appointment. So, with these people witnessing me, I'm appointing you my fiduciary. Do you accept? I asked him three times. And he said, I won't be accepting any appointments today.
How about tomorrow?
You can try. I mean, this is the point. I've done it. I've done it for everyone. Everyone should know this. They will not stand as to represent you at all, ever, never, ever, right? So there's no point in even asking them. There's no point in even thinking they might.
He came back with the fact that he could only represent the electorate, and the electorate is actually defined as an area of land.
Exactly. Exactly that. An electorate is not, it's nothing to do with man, male and female. And I make this distinction, there is only man, male and female. That's all there is. There's no human being, there's no human, there's no person. That's all fiction. And when you know this, it's it just makes your life funny. I had to be in intensive care, visiting a relative, and I picked up one of these things, which is what it's all about. The very first word on this pamphlet, consent. It's all about consent. Everything you do. And you give consent so easily until you start thinking about, ooh. The next battle we have with Torbay Council is they want to build, they basically want to turn it into Monte Carlo. You know, they want high-rise blocks all around the front, and they've been pushing this one for 4 or 5 or 6 years now, and they want 14 stories, next 12 stories, and now I think it's 9. And every time we've basically gone along and we've written a notice of rejection. What's the important thing is, there's no point in getting into groups over this. We all have to do this together, but not in groups. Because as soon as we get into groups, somebody wants to lead it. Somebody wants to take it this way, take it that way. We have to stick with one thing, and just all of us stay with it. And to me, if you want to stop something happening in your little area, you write a notice of rejection. It's as simple as that. Because they are more frightened of your handwriting than anything on the planet. Because your pen can get rid of them as easily as your pen created them.
It's using their own tools against them again, because when I went on to Hansard and I put into the search bar reject, and there were hundreds of references to reject. The word reject being used in the House of Commons. And at every instance where the word reject was used, it was the end of the matter.
End of story.
The matter was then stopped. That was the end.
A line
is
drawn.
Every instance. So that's the word they use. That's, if you the mayor has rejected.
That's right.
How many times do you hear that? They use it all the time.
We reject your petition.
Yes.
That's it. They don't say why. Don't need to. And the funny thing is, neither do we.
They had a
meeting in a different constituency to mine about this new building, and the old mayor, who I'd already had moments with, was sort of chairing it. And I went along, I walked in, sat down, he saw me and smiled. And it got very full, so I thought, I'll give up my seat, because, you know, it's the way I was brought up. And I thought, oh yes, that's right, the chap running the show, he said, there's a lot of people here, so questions and answers afterwards, but only from people from this constituency. I went, oh, well, there's no need for me to be here then. So I then went up to the mayor, and I presented him, well, I served him. I said, Mr. Mayor, or Mr. By, as his name is, you are served. And he was quite puffed up. You know, he says, I've got a good meeting going here. He started reading it. He went, and that was a wonderful sight. Seriously, that was a wonderful sight. You realise they don't like their words either. You know? So it's all about words. And as I say, the mother tongue is all that really counts. That's why in the olden, God knows how many thousand years ago, they didn't write things down. They sang them. Yeah. It's all about the vibration. We're vibrational beings. You know, it's all about vibration. Paper, it doesn't matter how much you rattle it, doesn't really say what's on it, does it? You know? So, any questions about things like a notice of acceptance or something like that? Yes?
You mentioned blue paper.
Yes. Basil and Bond.
We grew up with
Remember
it.
Basil and Bond? Bond. Yes. Interesting word, that, isn't it?
The original birth certificate is on a
bond. Yeah, a certificate. It's bonded. If you look through it, you'll see GRO, General Records Office.
Can you explain the difference between the different colours of pen that you use for different
colours? Yeah, I think so. Black is slave. It's the very bottom. Black is dead, yes, dead, that's the one. Blue, I believe, is regal, supposedly royal. Red signifies blood. I think purple is the sovereign. Gold, I'm not sure what gold's about, but people do write in gold as well. Do you know about gold, Mike? Gold pen? Ink?
It's the King's Edict.
The King's Edict.
Say what you know, we're offering used gold. For specific engagements in business. It's very private.
Right.
It's like, for instance, if I was to send, come to you with an introductory letter about my business, I'd have a gold leaf in there, flaked with gold.
Okay.
Yeah. There you go. That's the thing. That came via Simon the White Rabbit.
Yeah.
Very, very early on in his journey.
Everybody know about Simon White Rabbit? White Rabbit Trust on YouTube and Facebook. Simon's been doing this stuff for a long time. He used to work in a bank, and I think it was him that said that every Wednesday this chap came along and they called him the forger, because he got every mortgage and he forged the signature 9 times. Every Wednesday. Onto a new document. That's so it was, and then you've got 9 more securitizable money-making bits of paper. It's I'm getting tired of it.
The rejections you've administered.
Yeah.
Have they administered a rejection of your rejection? Does anything actually come at the end of it? So.
No. You use words like come. The last one I did, I made sure that rejection, I rejected the actual application numbers 3 times. And I did that by saying notice of rejection of application number blah blah blah. And then with this notice I hereby reject application blah blah blah. And for clarity, and to make sure you really know what I'm talking about, irrevocably and... No. Damn. Irrevocably and unequivocally. In other words, I don't want to see or hear anything about this topic again. Thank you.
So, like the building in Torquay, as far as we're concerned, say, like whoever action's actually happened, is that action, whether they wish to continue on from on there, your rejection was there first. So, are they just trying to bamboozle people as though nothing's ever happened?
Right, now I wrote as man. I'm trying to get rid of the surname that was appointed to me. Now, if you look at your birth certificate, you will see it says names, if any, and you have your Christian names or your given names written in that four corners. And because it's four corners, it's not actually on that piece of paper. Okay, then you go on a few more four corners and you see name and surname of father, which tells you unequivocally and irrevocably, there it is, that a surname is not a name. And that's very important. It's very important.
I believe that's written in glossary as well.
Generally, mine, they made mistakes with me. And that raised a giggle. It's normally in glossary. It's normally in full caps, which means it's a dead entity. Capitis Maximus. Yeah, it's a lot to go through all this gloss of stuff. But basically, if anything's written down, it's probably not English. If you get a form from government, at local or national, it will not be in the English language that you learnt to read and write. Okay, and the classic is the one where they get you to actually write in block capitals and each letter of your name is in a separate box. Now, that really isn't your name. Boxes, four-cornered boxes. Four corners is it. Anything on a piece of paper in four corners is not on that piece of paper. It's got nothing to do with that piece of paper. That's a difficult one to get in your head. But that's one of the games they play. It,
each box is a separate piece of paper.
That's one way of looking at it, yeah.
I went to court, right, and I pointed out to the judge that this piece of paper said the four corner rule, and he looked at it and said it was an old Deconian rule, and he basically just rejected my place of argument and found the guilty.
Yeah, judges tend to do that. If you go into a courtroom, you've had it. Well, they asked me to go into the witness box when I was, you know, into the. No, it wasn't the dock. I wouldn't go in the dock. I refused to go in the dock, so they allowed me into the court. And they wanted me to go into the witness box. And I said, is that four corners? And they just give him the book here. So then they gave me the Bible. Swear to tell the truth, whole truth, and nothing but the truth. Anybody here? Does anybody in this room know the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
If you wrote that book.
Right, but in a courtroom people go, oh yeah, I do. I mean, of all the places to lie, you do it in front of people who want you to lie. That's why they ask you.
It's actually not against the law to lie.
Oh, it is now.
Are you talking about a lawful court?
Okay.
The only lawful court in this land is a jury of your peers, according to Halsbury. And that's written down. So even that's questionable. You know, anything written down, I know it sounds crazy, but it makes me laugh now. I lived in Germany for a while and I learned the language, and it took me some time because I'm a thicko. And novels. But works of fiction over there are called Roman, spelled R-O-M-A-N, Roman. And it took me a while to put these two things together, you know, so Roman, fiction, good Lord. And you think that's just extraordinary. I mean, what if Rome was a fiction? And everything we've been taught is just complete and utter nonsense. All of it. Oh, they dug up a helmet. It's Roman. You know, everything. I can't believe anything now. I don't believe anything now. And it's quite fun. It's very frustrating sometimes. But what I want to put through is this letter of rejection. I think this is very important. It's simple to do. You don't have to write any explanation. If you don't want a planning application to go through, find out the planning application, send copies, keep the originals, always keep the originals. It's going to cost you, because you need to send it registered, because that's the Universal Postal Union rules. They start to take effect.
So if we deliver a letter by hand, it's probably better to use the system.
Best to use theirs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How can we though? Because they're selling it all off. No,
they're not.
Because it's living all together. It's a different kind of different rules. So it's totally different from the post office. You know as well as I do, in my six decades, the post office is you cannot say that this post office is the same as the post office as it was.
No, but the thing is that most of you think it hasn't changed.
No.
That's why you need to use their
special to
different, because they encourage you into that category.
You are, yeah. It's attached to them. They are then responsible for it. They're liable.
I'm going to the post office when we've got a bit of a snooty postmistress, and I often ask her questions about various things. So I'll go in this weekend now. In fact, I did ask her about the Universal Postal Union, and she'd never heard of it.
I wouldn't surprise me. I mean, I've been spending some time with the BCG bunch, the British Constitution Group, which I'm not a member of. But it's this group business. We've got to help everybody along the way. Everybody's got to stand up, basically. And however they do it, I don't mind. We've just got to stop conflict. But Pardon?
Here.
And
it comes from each one of us.
Yeah, it is down to each one of us. There's no point in trying to get to groups and say, well, you do it first. I kind of done it, and it's hard. It's bloody hard, because all sorts of reasons. On our website, we have some interesting films of our encounters with the council. And also the council tax stuff, which Nick is quite famous for. His film got on RT, ladies and gentlemen. We're not bad. We 8 seconds. 8 seconds. Which, you know, hey.
What's your website?
It's a YouTube channel. It's Talkie Talkie TV. That's Talkie Town. Talkie, as in Talkie, and TV. Good luck with that. There's a lot of boring stuff on because one of the things we wanted to show is how boring council meetings are. Because that's how they do it. That's all part of the business of keeping people out of it. If you're bored sick, you're going to walk out and not be interested, aren't you? You know, if you can't read what it says, I'll just sign it anyway. You know, people, that's what happens. They use that all the time, and we've just got to be a bit more mindful about these things.
The ethos in the council chamber changes immediately when you walk in.
It does, yeah.
They go immediately onto the fence.
Yeah.
So if you enjoy in the council meetings, lots of people would like to have 100 people sign that petition to come in front of the... Yeah, exactly. Right, for a petition on what we want to be answered. But in fact, the individual is going to be 100 individual
right.
Rejections.
Let me try...
This is having one...
This is the way I see it, right? This is the way I see it. To register something is to hand over title ownership of it, right? Apparently, every one of you in this room has got a vote, right? You've got one because they want you to register it. So there must be a vote of some sort. So when you register to vote, you know, most people think register to vote means register to vote in May or a Thursday in May or the next election, whatever. It doesn't. It means to vote, register. Okay? Now that actually means every year the government are... They have to ask every one of us, do we enjoy being governed in this manner?
No.
Yeah, but everybody answers. What they do is they send out a letter to the occupier, which is brilliant, because none of us are occupiers, but we all answer to being occupiers. Right? Yeah, all right. I'm going to generalize, because... So, you're an occupier. One who takes and holds by military force. You're the enemy. You can be charged. So they're going to bloody charge you. And that's why I said to the MP, inhabitant. Because I've read the Local Government Act, 1888, section 79, which says all duties and liabilities of a person, but you know, shall be and become the duties and liabilities of the County Council.
I recently ran my local borough council asking, because I live in the northeast of England, what used to be deemed as Cleveland County. Cleveland County was disbanded a number of years ago. I asked what county I now live in. They said the town I live in and a number of other towns in that region do not have a county anymore. They're not part of a county. As I was going to try and pursue the Local Government Act to the future set. And now we don't live in a county. And then a friend on Facebook said, it's all of the counties being responded, yeah. But we just don't know it.
They are still there. Still right to them. Even though with smoke and mirrors and everything else, they still are there. And it's the same as I can't remember what they call the CEOs of the council now. Is it the
chief executive?
No, yeah, chief executive. But they've got another name. Is it the?
No. They're not calling them chief executives anymore.
But the chief clerk is still there. They run in two different roles. So they're running the common law one and they're running this other one as well, and that's what we need to find out. See, Robert didn't know what that
yeah.
is.
All the notices we write, we write to the mayor and the Section 151 officer, because the Section 151 officer is the man to whom the chief executive officer answers.
And if you're from Nottingham, it's Glen O'Connell.
Glen O'Connell. Okay.
Max, just on a real basic level, when the council write to you, they know who lives there, so why are they writing to the occupier? Surely that's just
because of all the wonderful things they've done, it has to come out of your mouth.
They have to make you confess.
It's a confession. It's you that has to create and commit the fraud. Yeah, it's you who must commit the fraud. You know, it's like when a policeman says to you, "What's your name?" That's happened once or twice in my life. They're asking you to commit the fraud. Because, well, you can give them a name as it states on the birth certificate, so you give them your Christian names. They won't like that. You can give them your date of birth as well. They won't like that because it's not the same as the day you were born, or very rarely. There's two dates on your birth certificate. There's the day you were born and the date you were registered, which is the date of birth. Clever stuff. Clever stuff.
I just tell them I won't be needing a surname today because I'm not intending on birth.
No, I ask. I always ask. They ask me for my name and I say, am I obliged to have one?
What did you say? What?
I just tell them I don't because I'm not entering into any
contracts. I don't even bother with that because your average cop has got no idea what you're talking about. Got no idea. So you just say, am I obliged to have one? And that's enough for their brains to sort of just go back. I got arrested, I got thrown in prison. But from the very start, when I was given my rights, and they asked me, do I understand? I said, no, I don't understand. I will not accept any rights that you wish to bestow upon me. And furthermore, I'm going to hold my rights to myself, and from this moment on, I'm operating under duress.
What?
It was, I didn't get touched. They didn't manhandle me, they didn't, because from that, they hadn't got any consent to hurt me. Because as soon as you say your name, and your address, and your date of birth, you are now theirs. You are a slave. You have claimed what is not yours. And you've stuffed yourself.
How long did you get put in jail for?
I didn't do anything criminal. In my mind, I deregistered my car. I drove around in my car. They didn't like it. They arrested me and gave me four charges, some concerning ownership of the car, tax. When it got to court, there was one thing, which was you don't have insurance. And I was actually playing in Canada at the time, so I missed that. And 2 years later, they came and took me and put me in Exeter jail, prison for two weeks. Yeah. But that was funny, because when I came out of that, I think it was a couple of years ago, I've mentioned this before, a lady in Bath got murdered 40 years ago. I lived in Bath at the time, and it was a cold case, and two guys from Avon and Somerset Police came down to see me, and they wanted a DNA sample. And I said, why don't you look at my prison record, my criminal record? Because you can't, I said, can you go to prison without a criminal record? No. If you go to prison, you have a criminal record. I said, well, why don't you look at my criminal record? You don't have one. What was I doing in prison? What? Okay, so they didn't take fingerprints, they didn't take a mugshot, and they didn't take my DNA. And they put me in prison. 2 weeks. When I got to prison, they said, what's your name? I said, well, you brought me here, you must know who I am. I didn't accept it at any time, and it was all under duress. And it was kid gloves stuff. They didn't know what to do with me. He's not resisting arrest, he's not... And when you put handcuffs on me to take me to the court, that's not too tight, is it? You'd never hear of such things.
And you know when they did all that to you?
Yeah.
All unlawful, was it?
Well, I hadn't consented to it.
Right. So did you make some compensation in any... Is that hard to get off?
I'll tell you what, I forgive them.
All right.
I forgive them. Right? Okay. Because I'm man. Man forgives.
Well, could you not chase them for compensation if you wanted to push it?
Well, I might.
Please do, Nick.
We very recently, last year, were in court in Exeter, and we watched a very accomplished friend of all ours, Sarah Lyness. A few people must know.
Yeah, Sarah Lyness. Yeah.
We watched Sarah beat them in their own court and take away their jurisdiction.
Yes.
Yeah. And the judge said that she put her argument really, really well, but that it was a non-argument, and that he couldn't allow it because it would be anarchy.
There would be anarchy in the land, is what he said.
Yeah.
Right? And he said that in the courtroom.
And she walked out of that courtroom with a...
Right.
So her argument was not allowed. He just said it's not allowed.
Well, it's interesting because the
end of case.
The prosecuting.
That means that we went. She went in there. She beat them. She did everything that she needed to do to beat those people at their own game with their own rules. So don't think that you can go into that court and no matter how good or clever you are, that you're going to win because they can't afford to let you.
That's right. The prosecuting...
It's not their
world. We're not going to win in their
world. Look.
No, but
we're real.
It's not their
world. They have it in their own law dictionaries. It's defined. We're real. Right? And real is defined as in common law. If we do things, that's called real action. And that's at common law. And my favourite is reality. And that is in foreign law. That's from their perspective, reality.
So we're foreigners.
When I start talking about the Bible, I know people think, oh God. But the first chapter of the Bible, I think it's verse 27. God created man, male and female created he them. Species, the whole bloody caboodle, the whole lot. Doesn't mention anything about souls, names, or anything. Chapter 2 comes along. And this chap called the Lord God, who's written all in capital letters, Lord God. Right, we're talking 1611 when this was written, just after the registration of the Ministry of Justice as a private business. God knows how long the Law Society had been going before then, but they've already written their language, and most of the people can't read and write, so whatever they tell them, they'll get it. They'll do it. We are the end generation of years of bullshit. I mean, generations of it. And if we don't stop and see it, then that's it. We're all going to be chipped and God knows what.
Next question.
Yeah.
How can we change it all then if it's so bad?
We change it by doing precisely this sort of thing.
Okay.
Rejecting, removing consent. Once it starts, they're going to want everybody to go out on the streets, protest. Oh, they're dying to do that. You know they're dying to do that because they've got the kit. They've got the kit now, we're ready for you, come on.
They've got the kit all over the world when you look at the news.
That's exactly it, and it is all over the world. And, right, here's a big dive. Okay, when I was about, I don't know, 6-7 years old, this word kept coming into my area of hearing. Global Village. Global Village, never heard of it before then. Now, they've got a real problem. They've been pushing this global stuff for a long time, but I am not convinced it's a globe. And I'll just leave it there on that one. Any more questions?
We'll agree to differ on that one because I've never seen it and I only have someone else's information to go from.
I'll give you my reasons. I live down. I live down in Devon, on the coast, Torquay, and I can stand on the beach and I can see miles and miles of the Jurassic coast at the top of Nine Bay. I can see it. I think, well, so scientifically, whatever they call it, mathematically, it should curve. It should go down the first mile 8 feet, 8 inches, 8 inches, woo, 8 inches. The next mile, 32, and it squares, and it keeps going. Now, I've been on a ship across to Santander, and I said to the steward, has this ship got a list? And she said, oh, blimey, it's 1 degree. It's like that since it came out of the fitters. And you noticed. I noticed a 1 degree list. I can't see any drop, no curve in all those miles. So that's one. The next thing is every night the bloody North Star's there. And all the stars are circling around it. And we're travelling through the galaxy at what speed? And that's 320 light years away, and it's there every night for the last how many thousand years? Sorry, doesn't compute. My favourite, you go for flight, and when you sit at the gate, the plane waits for a bit, and what's happening is the co-pilot, they got these things called gyroscopes, and they have to synchronise. It takes about 10 minutes. And what happens is they stay in exactly the same position as they start in all the way through the flight. Now, if you fly from London to Cape Town, right, you would expect if it's standing like this at London and it starts going around the curve, it should be going back on itself. It doesn't happen. Now, it's a hard one. But it's easy, really, because we've been lied to about everything. Every damn thing is a lie. That's the way I see it.
Can I say something about the courts?
Yes, please do. Yeah.
Your colleague here said that it's quite true. What you're saying is if you go into a maritime court, you won't get any justice there. But your birth certificate's put into a CKT trust, and that's what they're after when you go to court.
Yeah.
If I personally went into court, I'd say, I'm a man called Mike. They'd asked me 3 times about the name.
You've already committed fraud.
Pardon?
You've already committed fraud.
I'm a man called Mike. What?
You've opened your mouth. it's actually, they've changed this, but you'll like this one. It's a simple word, it's uttering, which to utter is to speak. It's also to offer a document as a genuine document when you know it's a forgery. Or you don't even have to know it's a forgery. You only have to offer it. That's called uttering. Now, this happens on a daily basis when everybody calls them bailiffs. Stop calling them bailiffs. Right? They're not bailiffs. They are debt collectors. A court bailiff will come to your house, give you a piece of paper, and walk past you. And you've got the piece of paper to prove he's right. Okay? That's a court bailiff. A debt collector says, this says I'm coming to your house.
It does. It says I'm coming to your house. Let me in. It says I can come in. You know he's lying. Right.
That's called uttering. Carries with it a penal servitude sentence of not more than 14 years. Okay? And if he puts a crown on it, life. It's fraud. It's forgery. Right?
I'm sorry, I didn't.
It's a good one to learn. It's a good one to know.
I just said I was a man called Mike.
Yes, but you're uttering.
Can you finish, please?
Yes, sorry.
And they'll ask me about your my surname probably two or three times. I'll say, I'm here about that cow. So which one of you is the trustee? I'm the beneficiary of that cow. For example, sir.
How do you go?
They'll do a runner.
How do you go?
I don't know. I've never seen.
I had a go. I had a go. Got 2 weeks and next to prison. I understand what you're saying, but the point is, you're a man, you're real. If you go into a fiction and start talking to it, you're mad. It's a fiction. As soon as you accept it as being real, that's it. You're stuck in the fraud.
So what do you do?
Pardon?
I said, if you don't say no, we're just going to railroad you, so what do you do?
What you do is you head everything off with notices of conditional acceptance. I will pay. I will pay. Just provide me, please, with a lawful contract. A proper bill. Has anybody seen a proper bill? A proper bill is from, it's from the Bills of Exchange Act, Section 3, the first part says a bill will be a specific piece of paper from a person to another, and they will both, he will sign it. It will be signed by the person giving it. Right? Council can't sign anything. Nobody's ever had a council tax bill, ever.
We was in court the other week, right? And they just refused to accept it.
Of course.
They just said we're going to proceed as if they're not even here.
Of course, if you don't give them consent, they're going to play the game on their own. This is the joy of no conflict. We're turning our back on them, and they don't like it. They like that less than.
They're going to do it anyway. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, sure they are. What are they going to do?
Ask them for the contract before it gets there.
Somebody mentioned.
You said you were already there.
We was in
Cardiff,
and just like. No matter what he said, it was like.
Right, so did you write to them prior to the case?
Yeah, we did. We refused to give them.
You refused.
Sorry?
Never refuse. Refusing is like, what a fight.
We asked them for our court bundle, and they refused to give it on six different occasions. Every time they turned up at court, they lost it. And they just kept fobbing us off. And then eventually they got
just to
shaft us. They're only in, they were there just to shaft us. This is the interesting bit. We went to Teesside Crown Court, and the judge said, we'll just have a trial on a Sunday. Without your, we have to notify you during, before, or after. And I refuse to overturn that decision. That's what he said to us in court. And then he got up and left the court before we could even speak.
Hearing, yeah. It's not a trial, it's a hearing. I would go with notice of conditional acceptance every time. I will pay, just give me the contract. Show me the contract and give me a proper bill. Oh, and I'll also, for council tax, I'll also have a full statement of accounting for the last 10 years that I've been paying in, please.
So no matter what you're there for, just go for that?
Always go for that. You don't want to go to court. You don't want to go to court.
You don't want to be in court.
A man, male and female, does not belong in court. It's not your game. It's not our game. It doesn't exist. It's romantic. It's a Roman, it's a novel, but it's brilliant. I'm not saying it's not brilliant, but if they send you a letter that's addressed to your name, you write on the envelope, recorded for fraud, unclaimed, return to sender. There are lots of laws, loads of laws telling you you cannot open somebody else's mail, right?
Can we send it back unopened?
Unopened.
The one thing I'd say about that is if it's been delivered by UK Mail, which is in a white envelope, don't send it back, fold it up, put it into another envelope and send it back to the return address, because the post office returns it to UK Mail and UK Mail just bin it.
Yeah. Well, there's that, yeah. I like that one.
A UK mail runs out of the post office, the actual sorting office.
The surname they're using on every letter that you get does not belong to you. Remember this, right? Now, we haven't been paying council tax for some time, and I came out of the house the other day, and there was a lady with some piece of plastic telling me who, what, where, how. And she said, are you a tenant? And I went, what do you mean? They keep sending letters back. Who are they going to take to court? If you keep sending letters back, who are they taking to court?
Come to the point then where they just railroad it, because that's what happened.
Drag it.
Who with? Police? Criminal, is it? Oh, now we're going from civil into criminal. Oh, now it gets dangerous for them.
Max, the best one I've ever heard, and I can't remember who I stole it off, was if you go to an airport and somebody's got their case, you can't look in it.
That's right.
So when you go to court, if their case has anything to do with you, because it isn't.
Yeah. Listen, when the police start asking you questions, the first thing they do, when you're arrested, the first thing they do is, don't talk. That's what they tell you. Best thing for you to do is don't talk. You have the right to remain silent. And that means, actually, if you agree to it, that is the only right you have. Right? Once you say you have the right to remain silent, blah, that's it. All your other rights are gone. All of them. Just like that. And so you have the right to remain silent. And then you go into an interview room and you just stay silent.
The reality is that the police are thick, essentially. The officers, the individual officers are thick. They don't know what they're doing.
They're trained. They're trained. I wouldn't say they're thick. I'm not going to say that, because every officer I've ever met, they've got to do things that I wouldn't want to do. So, you know. No. They're men, male and female, just like us. They are men.
We've all been done down on purpose.
Exactly. Exactly. But if they're not wearing a helmet or a hat, they're not in uniform. That's another thing to remember.
Max, my brother's a copper for over 30 odd years.
Yeah.
Never ever got promoted because he joined the police when because he wanted to help people.
He wanted to be a constable.
Yeah.
There you go.
He's joined in the last 15 years. When I talk to him about all this, he says, "Where do you get all this crap from?" I said, "You mean that crap that just proves that for 33 years you didn't know what the fuck you were doing?"
It's just got worse though, because it was never like this. We used to have policemen coming to point duty in our house. Because they didn't have telephones or anything, you know, you had a telephone box if you wanted to make a call. Well, some people had a telephone, we were shot, and we used to be where everybody came if they had an emergency.
Yeah.
So the police used to come and sit, so I knew a lot about policemen and their attitude. And they were bobbies, and they were there to help people.
Yeah.
And they weren't there for a corporatized system that's there to shaft every one of us, and that's how they treat it, and we're the enemy if we don't comply.
Don't get me wrong, every in Torquay, every time I've come into contact with police, hasn't been a lot lately. They don't talk to me much anymore. I've asked them if they're on their oath, and within seconds they're off it. And I can't remember which act it is, but it says a police officer can talk to a man, male or female, if they're going to arrest them or they've got someone with them who's got an allegation, right? The next line says, a police officer may attract the attention of a person. Right? What's your name? They need a person. A police officer can only act on persons. Fiction. A constable, another story altogether. I don't think we've had constables in this land for some time.
The loud bellies when they want to name anything. If you kill somebody, hurt somebody, or steal off them, they don't need your name. They just put you in a van.
Yeah.
As soon as they ask your name, just show up.
Yeah.
And don't understand anything.
I don't answer questions.
Yeah. Man doesn't really... This might sound funny, but man doesn't actually argue. Ask questions. Really? Ask him. Ask him, because we're all sovereign. Ask him. We ask questions. Best to. You know, if you see conflict coming along, you know, just try and operate as a man, male and female. Yeah.
How come you're still against the hubs that's been built, and did you offer any alternative housing partners for the
council? How am I, why am I so against it?
Yeah. And did you offer any?
I'm an old fuddy duddy. I like Torquay. The reason I'm against it personally is because it's going to turn. They won't stop with one. Once they've got one there, it's going to change the whole of Torquay. Which, yeah, you know, they want change, but they haven't asked anyone who lives in Torquay what sort of change they want, or who's going to pay for it, and all this sort of stuff. And yeah, we've been learning about unusable funds, things like that. We, you know, they have a budget every year. They've got enough money to pay. You know, they're supposed to actually look after every one of us. That's what they're supposed to do. They get from the central fund between £120,000 and £180,000, depending on your status, for every man, woman, child. So that's an awful lot of money they're playing with, and they still want you lot to pay tax, you lot, us lot, everyone, you know. They want us to pay tax as well. They're just giving it out and throwing it back. It's a control mechanism, that's all it is. It's not really, doesn't exist, it's a control mechanism. Just to keep us not thinking.
And another, because we've got a problem in West Bridgford here.
Yeah.
Since I moved to West Bridgford 30 odd years ago, doubled in size. With the massive estates, they're now building on farmland out towards Taunton. Yeah. Now, fair enough, we need houses, but we don't need five-bedroom houses that people have to take five times their income to pay a mortgage for 35 years. This is what's wrong. We need affordable housing where we've got spaces. There's been stuff on London around here left empty for 30-odd years. I don't know what they're waiting for, but there's plenty of space to build proper affordable housing.
Okay, well,
for my kids.
Flex your muscles. Find out what planning applications you don't like.
Oh, I've been there, don't worry. And they've ignored everything I've done, but now I've got some more ammunition.
And a notice of rejection. Mm-hmm. And don't use your surname. And put a fingerprint on it, or a thumbprint. They don't know what it means. And it sort of frightens them. You know, we can only do little things, I think. I mean, we could probably do big things, but, you know, we get together, we do massive things.
There's that many of us that we could actually...
I think so. I think we can create ripples. We can create ripples that, you know, over there are bloody great waves.
Do we like to be bishops as well?
Well, that's another angle. That's a different ball game. That's a different ball game.
Bishop of Canterbury doesn't actually believe in God.
Does he have to? Is that part of the job description? I mean, yeah, we all believe in money. Does it exist? Yeah, you know.
Have you got any example of this notice of rejection anywhere online that we can get?
I think there may be one up. I'll put one up. I'll do one.
Do we have to be mindful of the general demand due to anyone that's considered being a threat to society in the class as a terrorist?
Right. Here's the thing. All Acts of Parliament relate only to persons. Now, the Representation of the People Act, 1983, section 202 tells us this. A person includes association, corporate, non-incorporate. Now, in the legal world, the word includes, it's like drawing a circle, right? And everything that's included is in the circle. So anything after the word includes is in the circle. Nothing else. So, person is association corporate or unincorporate. Okay, and I don't see a person here. No, you're not, love. You're
it's also come to my attention as well that with the lax and statutes, they also need a certificate as well.
I heard a really interesting story the other day. I don't know how true this is, but I can see this. Anybody heard of the Remembrancer?
Yes.
All right, the Remembrancer. Okay. Now, he is the representative of the City of London in the House of Commons, and he has a seat. Directly behind, we can't see him, he's directly behind the Speaker of the House. And I heard the other day, and I'm looking into this one, so this is only I can't think of the word, but it's only one of those. It's a rumour that every morning before Parliament begins, the Speaker of the House asks the Rememberer, the Remembrancer, are we still at war?
Yes, it's true.
And the Remembrancer says, yes, we are still at war. So what we need to know is who's we and who's we at war with. Because as long as we are at war, we're paying tax. Because that's what the tax was brought in for, to pay for the wars. That's another little thing. So yes,
have been written to and asked on. I bet you haven't been to Florida.
I haven't, but I think somebody's on.
I put
an FOI.
Yeah, I did, but for some reason it didn't seem to go through, so I'm going to have to do it again.
Okay.
So I think that anyone else wants to do it. So that.
Yeah, as many people ask as possible. It's great. You know, we're onto them. They know it. They're panicking. You know, they are. They are trembling up there.
Can I have another question for you? Just about war.
Yeah.
You said they're at war. Yes.
What is it good for?
Well, are we not the enemies?
That's what it's good for.
The occupiers.
Could we not be their enemies? So they're still at war with us?
Well, this is exactly what I've been trying to talk about, the idea of getting rid of conflict.
Yes.
And they get really frustrated if they haven't got anybody to fight against. They keep sending letters back unclaimed. Okay, so if you don't claim to be what they claim you are, now it's an interesting, because I mean, we're one day to the next, we can be different entities, creations, we can change ourselves every bloody day. They can't, we can.
So you say you've got multiple personalities?
I don't know, what do you think? Well, so anything else? He's all right. Good. I think.
Just one. I'll ask it because there's three parts to it. Do they know? Are they scored? And are they doing it intentionally? It's three things I ask myself every day since 9/11. But the likes of mayors, MPs, councillors, and the like. Because they're all singing from the same evil hymn sheet, and they're all doing it. To ourselves, we're doing it to ourselves, and there's absolutely no need for it. We could stop it tomorrow if we wanted to.
Okay, over the last 10 years or whatever it is that we've been doing this Talkie Talkie TV website, YouTube channel, we've got four maxims we've found out and seem to be, in every case, seem to be the fact of the matter. And now this is the question, can I remember them? Right, everything is 180 degrees from what we've been told. That's the first one. The higher up you go, in the more compromised you have to be.
Follow
the money, always a good one. And the lie is different at every level.
Which is the one that you're talking about.
Okay.
Do they know? Yes, the corporal knows what the sergeant's told him, and the sergeant knows what...
It's a need to know. Yeah.
Who knows what the adjutant's told him?
It's compartmentalisation. They don't need to know. So, to answer that question, there are a few people who know about the lot. I don't know anything. I only know what I ask. And they don't like me asking, so I like asking. It's not that I don't like, I mean, it's not that I like doing this sort of thing to councillors, mayors and MPs, but, well, they put themselves up there.
And they don't want to be challenged.
No, absolutely not.
It's such misery for everybody.
No, they're not used to it. They think it's some kind of, I don't know.
They're all psychopaths.
They think it's all some kind of a plot.
They're all psychopaths, I don't give a shit about it.
Of late there's been the talk of the bringing the population down. Now, how many people were ill this Christmas? Had heavy cough.
Yeah,
quite a few people. That apparently, I've been told, everywhere I go, the news agent's down the road, he knows everything. He told me all around the world, that one. All around the world. Georgia Guidestones, they're talking about 500 million people on the planet as being their, you know, their optimum slave handling trade game. People being evicted from houses in the middle of winter. I don't know. Is there some kind of cobble going on? Of course there is, and it's getting more and more serious. And if we don't actually start rejecting it, they're just going to keep going. They'll push and push and push because nobody's challenging, as you say.
Beyond authority.
Yeah, that's the common purpose thing, yeah.
I think the second cancer jabs for teenage girls is depopulating teenage
girls. Yeah. Well, I mean, when I was a lad, I don't know how many injections I had. It wasn't that many. But the kids these days, you know, when they're 5 years old, they've had sort of 60-odd bloody injections. Then there's the money, plastic money. You know, everybody's accepted this £5 note. you can actually see through it. Folks, you can see through the money now, you know, the cash. It's going. That's the next thing that'll go. So, in terms of working in groups, all I can suggest is that you work together to keep each other alive because, you know, we're all made of love, actually. You know, we've been taught to fight. We've been taught to be in conflict with one another, but we're all made of love, so we should love one another, and I think we will, we can, we do.